we learned about Mr. Adametz because I went on the honor flight with my own father, David Kalick, on May 7th. And at that point in time, we had the letters given to the veterans, and one of the letters went to Mr. Adametz from Sandy. And Sandy, why don't you stand so that Mr. Adametz would know who you are? And actually, Sandy, where are you? There's Sandy right there. There's Sandy. Mr. Adametz has come to talk with us today, and before I introduce him and say anything more, let's all stand and say the Pledge of Allegiance.
It ended up that that we took him to court, he was fined for it, he broke the law. So when I got to 18, I went to 19, was when I had to go and register. And I was classified 1A, which is the top of the line, to be available for duty. On March 3rd, I went for my physical, I got ready, and they said, okay, you're eligible. And they told me that I had 7 days to go home, straighten out my civil life, and then report back for duty. Well, the time came, I left, I got on a bus. This is all in New Jersey. I was born and raised in Garfield, New Jersey. And I was sitting on a bus looking out the window, and I saw my mother and my sister were standing there, and they were crying. And so did I. So we left there from the school. We left. We went to Newark, New Jersey. We got on a train, and we went to Fort Dix, New Jersey. And in Fort Dix, New Jersey, is where I turned from civilian life to military. I became a soldier. Then they put us on the train again, and they said we were going to go to Fort Jackson, South Carolina. And we looked at each other and we said, "What the heck is that? What the heck is something? Nobody seemed to know where to go in South Carolina." Well, I came down here sometime in early March, I guess 3 days later, and I was at Fort Jackson. I took training with the, there were a lot of 19-year-olds that were in there, and they told them they knew and didn't do anything to the division. It was 106, the shoulder patch was a lion instead. And I was there from that day on until about toward the end of June. And all the basic training was complete. And I don't want to go into detail, because if you name it, I did it. The one thing that I always brag about is that they taught us that the right, M1 right. They said that this is going to be your best friend, this rifle. And they taught me to take that rifle apart, clean it, and put it back together again. Blindfolded. You try to do that, it's not easy, but I did it. I was successful. Then they gave me a two weeks furlough. And I went back home and spent 2 weeks with my family. March and I were engaged to get married. And then of course my time was up. I had to come back here to South Carolina again. I know where it was now. And we went into some more basic training, extended basic training, a little more what was going to be like if I'm in, when I hit the war. And I think it was sometime in the late fall that I was taken out and sent to Fort Meade, Maryland as a replacement. And I was delayed there for quite a few weeks. I was going home on weekends. I was still seeing my fiance and my family and everything else. And finally, we boarded a plane. We went back, and they called us. We got on board a train. And the first time I went out there, I put my foot up to get on, and they called up my name. He said, "It was Vince Adametz." And all right, "Dear sir." 3277-1987. That's me. He said, "Okay, U81. That's when I was delayed. Finally, they put me on a boat, USS General A.E. Anderson. It was a brand new troop ship that was sailing. And we left. And we went from Fort Meade to the dock, got on a boat, and we ended up in Casablanca, French Morocco. And from there, we went over to and that was in 1943. Christmas of 1943 was on a Monday. And I'm not ashamed of it, but I went to church 3 times in 2 days, and I prayed to God, watch over me, guide me, take care of me, steer me in the right direction. And all I can say is, God, I'm still here. I'm 90 years old now. I'm still here. So somebody is taking care of me. So we left from Naples in Italy. I'm glad you brought that, Luke. Okay? That helps.
I don't have to get away
from you then. So when we got to Naples, I was assigned to the 3rd Infantry Division. That is the patch that had blue and white stripes on. I was going to wear that, but I figured I'd wear my white cap instead. So they put me in K Company, 15th Regiment, 3rd Battalion, 15th Regiment, 3rd Infantry Division. And I met my other buddy that I'm going to be with, and they looked at me and they said, oh, you wear glasses? We're going to put you up front where you can see them. And then somebody in the background followed, he's a rookie also. Oh, you're a rookie? Okay, then they turn around and they said, you're going to be a scout. And they gave me a bunch of guys. They were going to be my platoon. They would listen to me. So, and this was the early part of January. On January 20th, we left. And we didn't know where we were going. And when we got on a boat, so we knew where we were going to go. January 20th, 1944, got on the boats and we went up to Anzio. Now, I don't know if you kids ever heard of Anzio in Italy. A lot of people have never heard of it. So we were going to be invading and hopefully break up the battle that was going on in the casino in the lower part of Italy. So we left at 2 o'clock in the morning, and January 20th we left. On January 22nd, 2 o'clock in the morning, we got off the boats, we got off. I had my rifle with a bayonet on it, and we just walked all around the area looking, and there was no opposition. There were no Germans there. We had a bunch of guys that jumped into a jeep and they drove 11 miles all the way up to Rome. Our target was to free Rome, that would be the first capital in the European theater, that was free Germans. And then they came back. So when you're making landings like that, the one like we were, my platoon and a couple of others, we were the first ones off the boat. And we get to our objective and say, we got to get this, this, and this. We get to our objectives. And then the other troops that come behind us, they go through us and continue ahead. And we fall into reserve. So we fell into reserve. And we had the way that the layout was that the British were on our left. And our right was more American troops with us, the Rangers. Now we started to move up forward to establish the beachhead. Now the Germans were caught off guard. Shock to them. But right away they decided to pull back in the reserve zone to defend, and it made it rough for us. So we got up in the front line. I was walking up the gullies, and I'm not going to tell you what I saw there, and I'm not going to tell you what had happened to do that. When we got up and we made it, we established the front line. Our objective now is the division's objective was to free the city of Cisterna. It failed. We couldn't do it because the Germans held us back at all. Alright, so we sat back and waited for a while. At the end of February, the Germans counterattacked. Now they were going to get us off the beach. They were taking us back. Well, we were on the front line. I was in my foxhole, and they were in the daylight, our children would be flying, and children would drop them all around us. And my buddy in the foxhole next to me, he stuck his head out, and my fingers were quiet. He came over and he told me in defense, he says, "I saw that shell coming in," he said. "It went right under your foxhole." He said, "But it didn't go off." If it didn't, I wouldn't be here. So all I can do is say, thank you. And then we found out, we said, well, why aren't we getting any food, any rations, or anything? And then we found out because the Germans went so far that we counterattacked and we pushed it right back where we were. And then they pulled us off the front line. And I was having some problems with my stomach and all. I went to the aid station. And they took and checked me out and sent me, and put me on a boat. And they sent me back to Naples to the hospital. I was there for 2 weeks. And I thought I had diarrhea instead of an epidemic of dysentery. So while I was there, I knew my uncle was in the Air Force, and even in Fort Valley, was close to far from Naples. I went to the Red Cross, and I gave the information, and I waited. And I heard a familiar whistle in the door, and looked, my uncle was standing there. So he told me what had happened. When he got the Red Cross, he went to his commander, and he says, "I want my Jeep, and I want 3 degrees, and I want to go see my nephew in the hospital in Naples." He looked at my uncle and he said, "Mac," he says, "I can't do it just poof, just like that." And he says, "If my uncle turned around and said, if you don't give me the Jeep, I'm going to steal the Jeep, I'm going to go AWOL." Two hours later, he was on his way back to see me, came down to see me. And he went back, and then of course I went back up to the edge, he said again. And all my mail caught up with me. And I couldn't believe what I saw. I took the letters that were from my fiance and I stacked them all up. She was sending me a letter every day and sending it to me, and I looked at them. I read every one of them. She had a future ahead of us. In the top of my helmet that I was wearing, I had a picture of her in there. And the dress that she had that I really liked. And that was in my hat all during my tour of jury duty. When I came home, I still have that picture at home then. So we were resting over there, making a duty. We would listen to the radio at night. And there was, I don't know if anybody there, maybe all of you remember Axis Allen. She was an American, and she would get on the radio and she would spread a lot of propaganda. And then she remarked, "Oh, you guys are in the 3rd Division." She said, "We know where you are. You're down there in the forest in the resting area. We'll leave you alone until you come back on the front line. We'll get you there." Okay. Then we heard also that General Kesselring from the Germans, he had been interviewed, and he asked him what he hated it all. He said, "I hate the 3rd Infantry Division." And the president said, "Well, what do you mean you hate the 3rd Infantry Division?" He said, "Because they're good fighters. 3rd Division, was the first division to enter the war in Europe. And they landed in Captain Mike area, and then they fought in North Africa, and they went over to Sicily. Sicily, they went over to Italy, and then went back to Iran again. So, in battling, and while we were out on the beach, up on the front line, we never, ever did any patrolling or fighting or anything else during the day, because they could see what we were doing. So we do everything at night. Because the way it was, we were on down here, and then there were mountains going up, and that's where the Germans were. And they could see every move that we made. We went to a latrine, and they could see that. So we did nothing during the day. password was changed every night. The password is that you would say Ruth, I can say Ruth. Okay, I didn't get the latest password. I was in trouble. And he stopped me, and he gave me the new one, and I says, I don't know it. I give him, I says, I had my hands up, and I told him, I says, gave my name, my serial number. And he took one shot, and it hit by my feet. Didn't get it. So he says, advance to be noticed. So I started to walk up with my hands up to him. He looked at that, he put his rifle down, and he said, my God, Vince, he says, I almost killed you. So things were kind of rough there. Now, my birthday was on May 12th. And after all this fighting, everything quieting down, May 12th, my birthday came along. I came here to South Carolina, I was 19, I had my 20th birthday here. On my 21st birthday, on Anzio. And May 23rd was the jump off day. They were gonna break out. So everybody was training to get our objective where we had to go. We had to clear the town of Cisterna, and we had to get up and cut the highways that the Germans were using to send supplies down to the southern part of Italy. And we finally broke through, we cut the highways and all, and we got up to the mountains. And there again, well, when we were getting out of the reduced fighting at all, we were in the ditch going down, and it says, drop all your equipment, take your rifle and ammunition and your ration, and start crawling. We had to crawl on our belly because there were the trees with snipers. Well, we got over that. We made it to the mountains. We got up to the mountains, and we couldn't believe our eyes. Looking down, we could see everything that we were doing. They were using big artillery piece from that had a shell in it, 115 millimeter. It weighed 550 pounds and had a distance of 11 miles. They were up in the Roma area and they were firing those shells down and they were landing on the beach. That's what Ruby went around and said, you guys up in the front line are better off than we are back here. And one of the bombs happened to hit a hospital and did an awful lot of damage. And now I can see what we were up against for all those 4 months. And we fell in and we were there again. I shouldn't say this to young children, but we found a German kitchen truck that was on a crossroad and it was smoldering. So we went over and we played it. We got popped in with bread, sardines and mustard, and a couple of bottles of whiskey. So I says, oh, okay, I'm 21 now, I can get drunk, which I did. As a matter of fact, a lot of us did. Because we were in New York and the other troops were moving up towards Rome. Well, I had to pay for it because the next day I don't know how many miles I walked. I sweated as well. Marching along the road, and our Air Force came down and they strafed us, but they didn't do any damage. And then, of course, from breaking out of the beachhead, going up to Rome, it took us 12 days to get and occupy Rome. June 4th, we were in Rome. And my doctor was doing this in Bivouac right near the Colosseum. So I did get the Colosseum and saw what it really looked like. And then they said we were going to Paris and Rome. No, that didn't work. We were only there for a few days and they pulled us back to the back of Naples. And what did we do? We did some more training. And now, August 15, 1944, we landed in Saint-Tropez in southern France. And of course, this is June 4th, August 15th, we landed in Normandy, and they were pushing across the top were coming from the bottom. So it took us 25 days to get from the Adametz in France, southern France, to get up into Strasbourg, which was made it to Strasbourg. But that was fast. In between, we had a battle in the Vosges Mountains, and we're not exaggerating. If you go over there, you're up there, and that's looking at the mountains. And that was on guard, you mean that the ice was coming out of my nose. And very, very tender. But in doing the fighting in the Vosges Mountains, it was bad. And we were ordered, being another one of my buddies, we were ordered to take a couple of doors back to the aid station to make a move. Coming back, we couldn't find the company because everything was just moving fast. It took us 3 days to find the company. And we got to the company, they said, good luck to you. You were marking us down as we were missing in action. The division was looking for volunteers to take training and the whole thing was playing for us. You know, we were all playing for us on the Pacific Coast and continuing. But we were given Siegfried and Mohammed and all hands and we made Latin genius. So in Strasbourg, I met a nice French family, pretty girl, Jermaine, and they invited us to Christmas Day. And we got another callback. Now what had happened was the Battle of the Bulge had existed, and the Germans had set up the Colmar Park. And they called for help. The French needed help to clear it off because it was just like we had on the beach then. There was a hole that they set up on the Rhine River. So we went down there to help clean them up and all. Of course, I was no longer at the K Company. I was now in the Italian headquarters because of the planes were off. And a little brand new lieutenant from one of the companies called me up and smuggled us to go across about 300-400 yards and burn a third of the side of a house. And I looked at him and I said, "Is he crazy?" I said, "You expect me to crawl on this flat land over here?" I said, "We really need to get 2 feet." I said, "They'll kill us." I said, "Bring all my guys up with rifles and put on some phosphor shells and shoot those and get them in a house." And they did, and it worked. But it saved my life, plus a lot of other lives too. So we cleared up the Colmar project. We received the award from the French, which is the gold. Forward here, where I had a shoulder. From there we headed back up towards the, across the Rhine River, Rome, Worms. Now, they have to envision all the troops coming up from all the different countries, and they're pushing, and the Germans started to start running back as well. Well, we went into Nuremberg, we went down, I didn't move back up, so. And if this man would be flamethrowers, they made us what they call battle groups. So in my group, we were about 7 or 8 guys, and I didn't have a rifle anymore. Now I was using Thompson submachine gun. And they asked us to go down into the town of Augsburg, which I would have been back in the almost had to convince her. And they knew that I typed pretty good at the background. So they said, okay, this day, this one, that's going to be one of our clerks. So I was a clerk for the Underhill War. We had two places, we stopped in Austria, two towns, Rostock and Wagram. And then now we moved up into Waldeck, where we stayed to occupy Germany. So we were there for a few months. Well, then the word came through that the guys, soldiers were going home. And my time came up. And they said, look, this is, if you want, we would like you to re-enlist. I said, we'll make you a staff sergeant, and we'll give you 3 months furlough. Send you home 3 months furlough. I put it a second thought, and I said, no, I have a girl waiting for me. I'm going home. Okay. So they pulled us out of there, no longer in the 3rd Division, and we went to what they called Camp Chicago outside of Paris, where all the assembly was taking place, and all the troops that were going home. And if they had 76 points, it was very high. They were going by a point system. And we were waiting. I went to Paris for quite a few times to see what was going on, see all the sites there. I had a 3-year pass. I went to Brussels and went around there. I shouldn't say that, but there's a little statue that I got up there. It was cute. It belonged to a official that was inside and we got lost. And he said, wherever he is, wherever he's going, I'm going to make a statue over there. Well, he was over there, but I'll give you a second guess at what he was doing. So we come back from Boston, then we went to company headquarters. What are we waiting for? These guys are going home with less than 56 points, or 76 points. And they said, well, okay, we can't wait for them, waiting for the boats to take them out. What did they do? They shipped us out. They sent us over to England. So we were in England for a couple of weeks over here. Finally, they put us on a boat. They were, during the start of the war, the U.S. was giving liberty boats to the English people for support for the men in the air fight with Hitler. And there was two of them that came in, and they converted them to aircraft carriers. We got HMS Stalker and Hunter, and they put us on the Stalker and they brought us home. I come across the Atlantic Ocean. I don't know if anybody can get out there, but for the older one, you get out there in the Atlantic Ocean and it's rough. And I mean it's rough. The wind is enough to blow you off the deck. Well, we went down the south, and my biggest surprise was when we got back into Maryland and we docked the boat, I stopped and I looked around and I said, this is where I left from, 1942, when I went overseas. I left from the very same dock, and I came back the same way. The Red Cross was there, they had hot water, there were donuts, coffee, a bunch of people saying, welcome home, welcome, we should feel good. And then we went over to the camp there, and they said, well, what do you want? Anything that you want. I said, well, give me some milk. I haven't had any milk. I think I drank and a good turkey dinner. And they shipped me from there up to Fort Monmouth in New Jersey, which is my home state. And I called home from there, and they come down to see me. My fiance and her girlfriend, they came down to see me. They were the first two that I saw when I came home after being gone for over two years. I was good to see them. So everywhere we went in the boiler room, it was warm there. I was discharged on December 19, 1945. 3 weeks later, I was married. So when they left, I was discharged. I got on a train, went up to New York, and nobody was there to greet me. Because it was a snowstorm, believe it or not. Well, I was tormented with this. So I said, well, there's nobody here. I said, oh, my gosh, gets the bug out of here. We'll take me up to the second journey, take another one, take me to the car, New Jersey, and he was in Normandy land, he was in this way, he was wounded twice. So I got down close to him, I put my bag down, and I stood there and I said, "Oh, John." He turned around and he hugged me so hard. I was numb. He was so glad to see me. So we went inside and I saw my mother, father, my sisters, brothers, everybody, the whole family was there. I said, "Well, where's Marge?" He said, "Well, she left, she went down, she was gonna meet you at the station." Well, snowstorm was there, the delayed in the kitchen. So I stayed up and I waited. She finally got back at 11 o'clock at night. And we just grabbed hold of each other and fell on the couch and fell asleep holding each other. Tom Brokaw, when he had the dedication, reminded me, he said that all these millions of soldiers were all coming home, and all they wanted was to get out and get on with their lives. If you recall that, what he said, this is one guy that did it. I was home December 19th. Three weeks later, I was married and went on with my life. My brother and I, we never ever talked about war. The only thing he said was, "Vince, is that I have two purple hearts. I'll give you one, I'll keep one." Because I didn't get it. Why didn't I get a purple heart? I like that. And I went out of my life. I'm here today. My son over there. Tom was actually we call him Easter the Birds. We flew the food day. I think that covers most of it. I may have forgotten some stuff. I don't know. I brought this with me for reference, but I didn't even look at it because I remember everything like I said I didn't know what I remember. It was not fun. It was a funny time, and it was a time to see.
Hitler in the war? Were you fighting Hitler in the war?
Well, we were all, from the beginning when I was in Italy, we were fighting against Mussolini. And of course, when we got into the Europe, we were fighting this Hitler most of the time. I never saw him or anything.
Eating, reading, and a big meal in the restaurant.
Have you got any?
problem that I did with this was Adametz in, on the beach there. And I went to the hospital because my stomach was put out. And I had to go to the back, just to do it. Other than that, I don't know, maybe I was scared most of the time. Maybe I wasn't, I don't know, but I had a job to do it.
Do you want to explain to them what kind of food you had? Did you not have what they call the sea rations in the can? You might want to tell them about that because I've actually eaten some of those.
There were three rations that we had. Sea rations, sea rations, and beef rations. The sea rations, the cave ration was some kind of food in there, a sack of pork in there. And the other one, the D ration, that was the one that when we knew we were going to get into combat, they gave us that. That was a signal. So we always had candy bars, all the candy bars with us.
And the food was really good, wasn't it? And the food was delicious, wasn't it?
And then, of course, the Winter War was over. The German kids were all running around. And I said, yeah, Joe, you got any candy for us? You got any chocolate? Yeah, Joe, it's all we had. We had to give it to you.
Do you have
any family members still living that fought in the war? No. My brother was 84 years old. My uncle was, he was the first one. I am the only one that was in my family. Mother, father, my two sisters, and my brother are all gone. But I'm still here now. And I keep saying to my son, I'm going to survive to 105.
120.
I've been to 105. I don't know if you're going to talk to me, but I would probably be the last in the world.
Just
for
nothing, you're
going to be
your question is, where do they sleep? This is a teacher question.
Oh.
I was asking. She wants to know, have you been back to that area? Have you been back to Italy or Austria or any of those countries?
My wife and I, we've talked many times and saying, oh, wouldn't it be nice to go back and see Andrew Long? When I was in Rome, I didn't get to see the Vatican because I was still around there. And, from across the land and all, we thought we were going to go to Rome and Susie called. I don't think I want to go. I didn't want to go to Rome.
Do
where we are, in the United States.
Email.
Facebook.
Email or how else?
Facebook, phone.
Facebook, all those kind of things. Was he able to do that with his fiance?
No.
No, no, and why not? So when Mr. Adametz was in the military back, when he was there, beginning back in the 1940s, it was totally different. And you understand that he said when he got all of those letters from his fiance, you know, he got a whole stack at one time. You know, he got a whole bunch of them at one time because, you know, they just accumulated. And then you get them like every day when you go to them. Because they were on the move, just as he said, they were on the move. And he has on the mail, you know, mark where it is. Maybe we could just come out and come by here and take a quick look, you know, as a path if he went. But just remember that they came over. My dad talks very little about this kind of in service, just like Mr. Adametz said, when they got home, they just got married or whatever, and went right on with their lives. And it's only now that most of the veterans are beginning to tell us anything about retirement service. And it's so important, boys and girls, if your grandfather, and in some cases your grandmother, were in the war, or for many of you, it was your great-grandfather or your great-grandmother, or you have a neighbor that was in World War II, make sure you know what it is with that person and help them there. And learn what you can about the war. If you sit down with a person like Mr. Adametz, you're going to learn so much. You're going to learn so much, and you will appreciate what you learn. You'll really appreciate it. Every time, I have an aunt who lives at the nursing home. The other day I visited with her, and she mentioned a couple of things about my daddy's time in the war that he had told her. I grabbed a piece of paper out of my purse and started writing that down so that I could go home and put that in the journal.
When I made my trip across the Atlantic, it took us all days to get across the Atlantic a long time. Because when we were going across, we were doing this. It was zigzagging. Why were we zigzagging? Because the Germans had submarine vehicles underneath and they were just looking for something that they could go up. Why it took so long. You know, I do it, yeah. Just to go across.
We certainly want to thank Mr. Adametz for